Y'all believe in the resurrection? Well, we live in a great place in central Louisiana where there are a lot of Christians and Christians that actually believe in the death, burial, and resurrection of Jesus Christ. Amen. I've been studying this week and I found out that not all Christians believe that Jesus was risen from the dead. I said, well, how can you be a Christian if you don't believe he's alive? We serve a risen Christ. We're going to worship the risen Christ this morning. Our God loved you so much, he sent his only begotten Son to die on the cross for your sins. Amen. That whoever believes in him should not perish, but have what?
Everlasting
life. I'm in this for the everlasting life thing. I don't know about y'all. You know, whenever you just think that you die and you go back to the dirt and you don't exist anymore, the Bible actually says we're pitiful if that's what we believe. That we only serve God and Christ in this life and not believe in eternal life. I don't know about you. The eternal life thing is good. Amen. So if Jesus was not raised from the dead, then what are we doing here? How would you claim to be a Christian if you don't believe in the resurrection? He's alive and he proved himself to be alive, and we'll be looking at the scripture, but we're going to worship him. We have a couple of special things we're going to be doing today, and we're going to have communion. So at the end of service, we want you to come to the Lord's table. It's not my table. It's not the table of Christian Family Worship Center. It's Jesus' table. He instituted it. Amen. And all of you are welcome to come if you're a believer. Why would you want to come to his table if you don't believe? Amen. So if you're a believer, you're one of his children. You're a son and a daughter of God. Your name is written in the Lamb's Book of Life, and you're welcome at the table. You know, some churches teach, well, you know, if you got sin in your life, you better not come to the table. But no one would be able to come to the table. For all have sinned and fallen short of the glory of God. That's what the Bible says. Amen? And then you can find out in the book of 1 John chapter 1, it says, if you say you have no sin, you're a liar, and you make him out to be a liar. And the truth is not in you. But you know what? If you confess your sin, he's faithful and just to forgive you of your sin and to cleanse you from all unrighteousness. So we're going to open our hearts to God. Let him do some work in your heart. Come to the table. Partake of the wine, the blood of Jesus, which represents the blood, and the bread, which represents his broken body. One's for the forgiveness of your sin. The other's for the healing of your life, healing of your body, healing of everything going on in your life. So we need to come to the table. Other denominations and churches say, well, if you've been through a divorce, you can't have communion. Please find that scripture in the Bible. It's not in there. Amen. Amen? In fact, you need to get free. You need to forgive. You need to be healed. Amen? Amen. So we don't separate the church because here's the good Christians and here's the ones that have problems and here's the ones that went through a divorce. No, we're all the same when you come before God. All of us are guilty and need to be forgiven. And you know what? Because Jesus died on the cross for your sins, was buried and was raised from the dead, he has forgiven your sins. You need to receive it this morning. Believe it and be set free, forgetting those things that are behind, pressing on for those things that are ahead. Reach for what God has for you. I'm ready to start preaching. Amen? If anyone's in Christ, they're a new creation, a new creature in Christ. Old things pass away and what? All things become new. Now all things are of God who has reconciled us to himself and has given us the ministry of reconciliation, because he is not holding your trespasses or your sins against you. God loves you. Amen. If there's one thing I want you to believe this morning, is that God really loves you more than you could ever imagine. Amen. I'm so glad he loves me. Amen. He loves us Bayou Blancs. He loves the Pont Megs. He even loves people from Plocheville, from Beldo. From where? Where are y'all from? Hesmer, Marksville, Bunky, Gudo, Cottonport. He even loves people from Cottonport? Baton Rouge. Come on. It's an amazing thing to be a child of God. And this morning, there's probably more people in church at this time of year than any other time of the year. Amen. You know, there are some Christians that only go to church on Christmas and Easter. I hope you want to go to church more than that.
Amen.
But you're here today, and we're going to worship our King, our Lord, and our Savior. Let's go to Him in prayer. What a privilege to be able to go to Him. Father, we come to You today in Jesus' name. We surrender our hearts to You. We humble ourselves before You, knowing that we need You today more than ever. This world needs You, Lord God. We need a supernatural move of Your Spirit. This world, this community, our church, the churches in this community, we pray for revival. We pray for people to come alive in Christ. Amen. We pray for them to turn from darkness to light, from the power of Satan to the living God. We pray for our families, our children, our extended families, our loved ones, that, Lord, You'll reach out supernaturally by Your Spirit and draw them to You, because no one can come to the Father unless You, Holy Spirit, draw them. We pray, draw from the north, the south, the east, and the west, those who need to be in the kingdom, in church, not just this church, all the churches in this community. Anoint every pastor this morning. Anoint every leader. Anoint the worship. Anoint the singing. Anoint the everything, Lord God. Communion, our worship with the offering, everything. Lord, let it be supernatural what's going to happen in our lives today. I just want to thank You one more time, God, for Your grace, for we are nothing without it, and Your mercy. Because You don't give us what we deserve. You give us Your love and forgiveness. Have Your way in us today. I pray in Jesus' name. Come on, let's shout hallelujah. Let's worship God. Greet somebody this morning. Let's worship the Lord.
Bought my freedom, hallelujah. And all alone, your presence was where I found home. You were there and you're here right now. In every high and every low, you never left me without hope. You were good and you're good right now. I've witnessed your faithfulness. I've seen you breathe life within. So I'll pour out my praise again. You're worthy, God, you're worthy of all of it. Your promises never fail. I've got stories I live to tell. So I'll pour out my praise again. You're worthy, God, you're worthy of all. You left the throne and chose the cross, laid down your life to rescue us. The Savior then, the Savior now. But even death was not the end. You conquered hell so I could live. Resurrecting then, resurrecting now. Yes, he is. Resurrecting then, resurrecting now. I've witnessed your faithfulness. I've seen you breathe life within. So I'll pour out my praise again. You're worthy, God, you're worthy of all of it. Your promises never. You're good and I've witnessed it.
Has it been good to you?
You're strong and I've witnessed it. You're constant, I've witnessed it. And I'm confident I'll see it again and again. You love and I've witnessed it. You heal and I've witnessed it. You save and I've witnessed it. And I'm confident I'll see it again and again. You're good and I've witnessed it. You're strong and I've witnessed it. You're constant, I've witnessed it. And I'm confident I'll see it again and again. You love and I've witnessed it. You heal and I've witnessed it. You say. And I'm confident I'll see it again and again. I witnessed your faithfulness. I've seen you breathe life within. So I'll pour out my praise again. You're worthy, God, you're worthy of all of it. Your promises never fail. I've got stories I live to tell. So I'll pour out my praise again. You're worthy, God, you're worthy of all of it. To the broken, I witness it. To the hurting, I witness it. To the lost, I will witness it. And I'll tell them this. I'll tell them what I witness. To my To my city, I witness it. To the nations, I witness it. And I'll tell them this. I'll tell them what I witness. I've witnessed your faithfulness. I've seen you breathe life within. So I'll pour out my praise again. You're worthy, God, you're worthy of all of it. Your promise. again, you're worthy, God, you're worthy of all of it.
Worthy is the Lamb. Hallelujah. Let's give him praise this morning. Amen. Come on, how many of you believe he's alive? Glory to God. You may be seated. Good morning, everybody. Because it's Easter Sunday, we're keeping the children in. Amen. It's good for the children to be able to sit down in church. I know whenever I was growing up, I would go to church with my mamaw. If I didn't keep still, she taught me how to keep still. Amen. Boy, they know how to pinch real good. Amen. I miss my mamaw. Amen. Anybody miss anybody that's already in heaven? Oh, glory to God. I miss some people that are in heaven. But you know what? You know why I believe they're in heaven? Because I believe in the resurrection of Jesus Christ. We need to believe in that great, great scripture, John 3:16, for God so loved the world that he gave his only begotten Son, that whoever believes in him should not perish but have everlasting life. Everlasting life. Amen. Well, you know, as I was preparing this message this morning, I'm going to be talking about the resurrection of the dead. As Christians, we have hope. Come on, you can amen me. It's going to be better if you do. Other religions do not have that hope. Most people on the planet do not believe in a resurrection. Do y'all realize that? They don't believe in life after death. There's a lot of people who don't believe that. So I looked up a few things, and there's a lot of things that surprise me. Just 17% of the general population believes word for word what the Bible says about the resurrection. Only 17% of the people believe the word of God. Wow. How many lost people are there? They're everywhere. And they're living a life without hope, without faith, without the love of God. They have a love, but it's not agape love. Amen? Amen. Only 20% of all Christians actually attend church. Now think about that. And I looked up, I wanted to find out how many Christians are there on the planet right now. And we found out 2.4 billion. That's a lot of people. But only 20% of those people actually attend church. And then on a regular basis, like, are active in a church, it's way less than that. It's usually about 20% of the attenders that actually serve. Well, we need a revival in the church now. Now, if you came to get your ears tickled, you're at the wrong church. I'm going to tell you what the Word of God says. But Christianity, somebody say praise, is still the biggest group of people on the planet. 1/3 of the population, according to the statistics, is Christian. That's larger than any other religious group, larger than any nation, larger than any other population. So we have brothers and sisters, the church is all over the world. This means 1 out of 3 people on the planet are Christians. Are confessing Christians. Okay? Do you know that's more than all the people in China? Really? China only has 1.4 billion people. It's more than all the people in China and Europe put together. I want you to see how many people on this planet confess to be Christian. Now, that would be Protestant and Catholic Christians, those who believe in the death, burial, and resurrection of Jesus Christ and confess to be a Christian. It's more than Europe, China, and the U.S. all put together. The church is still bigger than all three of those nations. Now, just kind of get that in your mind, how big the church is. Whenever I do mission work, and I've traveled and done mission work, everywhere you go, you can find a brother or sister in Christ. But do we all do what God's called us to do? Serve one another, love one another, be hospitable to one another. Come on, whenever you have two coats, you give another one to someone that might need it. So that's pretty amazing. That 1 out of every 3 people on the planet confess that Jesus Christ is Lord. And then when I was looking this up, just to let you know, the second group that is in there is Islam, and they have 1.8 billion. The next group that comes in line is secular people who don't believe in religion at all, or believe in anything. The secular atheists, 1.2 billion people. How about that? Then the Hindus are 1.1 billion, and the Buddhists are just 521 million. So Christianity is still the largest organization, or organism, I like to say, body of believers on the planet. And I'm praying that as we come to the end time, that more and more people will be turning from darkness to light, believing in the death, burial, and resurrection of Jesus Christ. And the only way that's going to happen is if we get a hold of the supernatural power of God. Because we cannot save the world. Jesus will save the world through us. We need the Holy Spirit more than ever right now. And you can't be afraid of the Holy Spirit. When the Holy Spirit starts doing things, it's way beyond our ability to comprehend sometimes, because it says even when we pray in the Spirit, our understanding is unfruitful. In other words, when you pray in the Spirit, your spirit talks to God and you don't even know what you're saying. But you're talking directly to God and you're speaking mysteries. And you know, as Christians, we need to embrace mysteries a little bit more. We think as human beings that we're supposed to understand everything about everything, and if we don't understand it, we can't believe it. No, there's a lot of things I believe that I don't understand. Amen? Amen? Amen. Glory to God. I do not understand how you can flip a switch and the light comes on. Well, I kind of do now, but, you know, there's power here. Do y'all realize right now there are so many radio waves and different, cell way. There's stuff all flying out through here, and you can pick up your phone. And I don't understand how that stuff. They can send me a picture through the air. That's amazing, isn't it? I can remember whenever I started the Cricket Internet Company way back in the 70s. I was one of the founding owners. We went to a big expedition in Baltimore to see the new technology, and we were amazed that we could actually see a concert going on that was going on in California, and we was in Baltimore, and it was like, this is the big thing. They're actually streaming this stuff way back in the 70s, but they had to have some super duper, fiber and all kind of stuff to do it. Now you just pick up your phone and you can watch any channel on any TV or watch any video about anything, anywhere, all y'all at the same time. Isn't that amazing? Do y'all understand how all that works? But you still use it. We don't always understand everything about why God did the things he did the way he did them. And so secular people, and I have some secular friends, I have some friends that know about Christianity, but they don't believe it because they don't understand how God would give up his son for you and me. Because they said, I wouldn't give up my son for you, but you're not God. And plus God, the reason he could give up his son is because God is the God of the resurrection. Amen. So we need to be believing in the resurrection. Amen. Open up your Bibles to 1 Thessalonians chapter 4, verse 3. Father, I just yield my body to you, my voice to you, and in my weakness be made strong. Bring forth a word that can change our lives in Jesus' name. Amen. Amen. So I want to talk to you about the resurrection of the dead. Because if Jesus wasn't risen, then none of you are going to be alive. Amen. Why do we need to believe in the resurrection? It is the seal of everything that God has promised. If there's no resurrection, the cross doesn't mean anything. Y'all do know that many, many men and people were crucified on the cross. They were tortured and were killed on crosses in those days. But there was only one that was taken off the cross, put in a tomb, was buried. Come on, say buried. That's important. For 3 days, and then he was raised from the dead on that Sunday morning, first day of the week. He wasn't resuscitated. Come on now. Y'all know there's a difference between resurrection and resuscitation. There's probably somebody in here that's been resuscitated before. Your heart stopped. They said you was dead for 10 minutes or 5 minutes or 15 minutes, and they resuscitated you. That's not resurrection. Let's get it straight. They didn't bury you, they didn't put you in the tomb, and then you didn't come out 3 days later. And some people, when they have those near-death experiences, they go to heaven, or some of them go to hell and come back and say, you don't want to go to hell. The ones that come back, write a book about heaven, said, you want to go to heaven. Well, the only one that really can tell you about heaven and hell and life after death and the resurrection is the one that was resurrected, and that's Jesus Christ. Amen. So we're not talking about resuscitation. Well, thank God for all the things that you can resuscitate, you know, bring somebody back. Thank you for the medical stuff and all that. But man, Lazarus was dead for 4 days, and Jesus went and said, Lazarus, come forth. And he comes out the grave. And he was dead so long that his sister said, Jesus, you know he stinketh by now. Now that's dead when you start stinking. But Jesus was able to raise him from the dead. And what's so exciting about the resurrection is that we know that life doesn't end at death. Amen. Go on. Why else would you want to be here if you don't believe in the resurrection? If you just believe you're going to go back to the dirt, what's the point of being here worshiping a God of the resurrection? A God that promised us the gift of eternal life, everlasting life. Starting with verse 13, 1 Thessalonians chapter 4, verse 13. This is one of my favorite portions of Scripture. I like to teach on it and talk about it all the time, because in the Christian world and the world of theology, a lot of people got this all confused, and I think it's so simple when you read it for what it says. So I'm going to preach and teach a little bit on this. But I do not want you to be ignorant, brethren, concerning those who have fallen asleep, lest you sorrow as others who have no hope. Let's talk about that for a moment. He says, there's a lot of ignorance in the church about people dying. We need to not be afraid to talk about what happens when you die. Amen. Christian, do you know what's going to happen to you when you die? The Bible tells you what's going to happen to you. And he says, I don't want you to be ignorant about you who are going to die believing in Christ. When he says those who have fallen asleep, that same term means that those who die believing in Jesus. You fall asleep in this life and you open your eyes in the next life. Come on. You're not going to stay asleep. And guys, the preachers that talk about you don't want to live by the graveyard, because whenever Jesus returns, the graves are going to be popped open. I don't want that old dirt dead body out in that graveyard. I got a new body that's in heaven. That's what the Bible teaches. A temple prepared for me in heaven. In fact, in 1 Corinthians chapter 15, it says, I have a natural body and I have a spiritual body. Already have a spiritual body. You just can't see it. But once I get out of this flesh and blood body, I'm going to be in my spiritual body. Jesus was on the Mount of Transfiguration, and he peeled back his flesh just a little while, and he glowed like the sun. And the Bible says, as he is, so are we. We're going to be just like him. So they say, what are we going to be like when we're on the other side? Like Jesus? There's several scriptures that say that. I'm not going to get into that deep of a teaching. But if you keep coming, I'll talk about those things. Because in Philippians chapter 3, it talks at the end of the chapter, it says, our lowly bodies will become like his glorious body. Somebody say hallelujah. I want a glorified temple. Because this one right now is a mortal temple. You know how I know? Because my knee hurts every now and then. I pick up something too heavy, my back kind of hurts. I can't run and jump off of stuff like I used to when I was 21 years old. To think when I was 21 years old, I could actually run and do a front somersault with a full football uniform on. Yeah, that's wow. Thank God. I got a video of some of that somewhere, but whew, if I just jump off of here, I'd probably have to go see somebody to help me. So he says, we're not going to sorrow, lest you sorrow as those who have no hope. I have hope. So when we lose a loved one, when someone dies, we're going to just talk plain. When someone dies, we're going to sorrow, we're going to grieve, but we're going to do it in the hope of the promise of the resurrection. Amen. That's what Christianity has that no other religion has. Now the Muslims, they got something. They say, you know, if you die for the cause, and the radical ones, that you're going to die and then you're going to wake up and there's going to be like, 72 virgins. Hallelujah. I'm married, and I got one beautiful wife, and I don't need 71 others.
Amen.
Amen. Glory to God. So that's just some kind of fantasy thing. Amen. So let's get this in our thinking. Those who have fallen asleep means those who believe, who died believing in Jesus. Now, there are some translations that actually tell you that. Okay? For if we believe that Jesus died and rose again, how many of y'all believe that he died and rose again? The resurrection right here. If you do, if you believe, even so God will bring with him those who sleep in Jesus. Those who died believing in Jesus. That's what that means. So listen to these words. We don't just read it without thinking about it. If we believe that Jesus died and rose again, and I do that, even so God will bring with him, say bring with him. So that means those who died are with him. Come on, am I twisting it, or does that what it mean? Y'all see it? Even so God will bring with him those who died believing in Jesus, those who sleep in Jesus. So when you die, it says to be absent from the body. That's when you die, you leave your body, is to be what? Present with the Lord. Amen. Not in some holding place waiting. Absent from the body, present with the Lord. When he comes, he's bringing with him those that are with him. He's going to bring, because they're with him. Amen. Complicated stuff, right? And he's going to confirm it again. For this we say by the word of the Lord, that we who are alive and remain, turn to your neighbor and say, that's you, until the coming of the Lord will by no means precede, that means come before, those who are asleep, or those who died believing in Christ. So we're not going to get to him before them because they're already with him. Amen. When he gets up to come, they're going to be coming with him. We who are alive and remain, and I can precede them because they're already with him, we're going to be caught up to meet them. Listen to what he says. See, I believe in the rapture, but kind of not like a lot of the traditional churches do. I believe what the Bible says. Amen. Come on, somebody say amen.
Amen.
Okay. Yeah, verse 16. For the Lord himself will descend from heaven with the shout of an archangel, with the trump of God, and the dead in Christ will rise first. The dead in Christ is that same group of people, those who died believing in Jesus. Will rise first, you know why? Because when he gets up to come, they're getting up with him to come. This doesn't say nothing about them coming out of a graveyard.
Amen.
Y'all see that? Okay. Then we who are alive and remain shall be caught up together with them in the clouds to meet the Lord. So they're with him when he comes in the clouds. We're going to be caught up to meet him if we're here when he returns. And what does it say? In the clouds, to meet the Lord in the air. And thus we will always be with the Lord. Comfort one another with these words. This means all of those who died believing in Christ are with him. And when he gets up to come, we who are alive and remain are going to be caught up to meet them in the air. And it's going to be a great family reunion. And we're going to always be with the Lord. Comfort one another with these words. The resurrection should comfort you. The resurrection should give you courage. The resurrection should take away from you the fear of death.
Amen.
The resurrection shows us that Jesus Christ conquered death and the grave. Go with me to Hebrews chapter 6, verse 1. Hebrews 6, 1. It says, therefore, leaving the discussion of the elementary principles of Christ, let us go on to perfection or maturity, learning more. Not just talking about it. These are elementary things we should know as Christians. Not laying again the foundation of repentance of dead works and faith towards God. That's your foundational thing. You got to repent and have faith in God. Or the doctrine of baptisms. Understand that you need to be baptized. Or the baptism of the Holy Spirit is baptism plural. I'm not going to teach on that. Or on the laying on of hands for the healing, for our ordination. And then it says of the resurrection of the dead. This is an elementary thing that we should be able to talk about, is the resurrection of the dead. Come on, do you believe in the resurrection of the dead? Because you know what? Surprise, surprise, you're going to be one of them one day. You're going to die. And if we don't realize that, we live like we're not going to die. We live like there's going to be no consequence. We live like the Word of God says in the book of Hebrews chapter 9, it's appointed unto men to die and then after that to stand before the judgment of God. It's appointed for every one of us to die. But don't be afraid if you're a believer. And when you lose someone, cry, grieve. You're not going to see them here. I talked about that this past week. The sting of death, it comes and it stings. You know, whenever you get stung, it's always a surprise. You see, it'll be all of a sudden, it stings you. But the sting of death can hit you at any time. Do you all realize that tomorrow's not promised to anyone? That you don't even know if you're going to be able to make it home tonight? Except by the grace of God. We don't know our time, and we don't know how it's going to happen. Come on now. And the sting of death can come. And I thought about this, and I talked about it this last week. When I was a young boy, the first time I saw someone that was dead, it was one of my neighbors. After he died, I never saw him again. And as a young boy, like 7, 8 years old, that was surprising. The next thing you know, I go through life and here's another person. And then when my dad died, which was a sting because we did not know that he was going to die. It happened quickly. I saw him that morning. I prayed with him. He goes into surgery. He never comes out of surgery. I never talked to him again. I worked with him every day. Never, the desk was empty. We'd go hunting. He wasn't at the camp no more. We'd go to the camp in a Jeep full of mud, taking all day to get there, and we were closest of friends. Gone. I grieved. Sometimes, it took a little while, but there were some nights I just would ball up and cry because I missed him. He was gone. But I knew where he was because 3 weeks before he died, he walked down the aisle of the church that I was a member of and gave his life to Jesus Christ. At 50 years old. And that's why that morning before he went into surgery, we prayed and he looked at me and says, I never felt Jesus so close to me. He would never use the name Jesus. Talk about knowing Jesus. He says, Jesus is like in this room with me. And we prayed. That was the closest he ever was to God. And then I don't see him again. So God gave me that as my hope. But I grieved. I still grieve to this day. 38 years ago that's been. He was 50 years old. The sting of death can come at any time. But we are Christians. We believe in the resurrection of the dead. We believe in life after death. I'm going to tell you, the true evolution, not what they teach in these schools and all that, is the evolving from this life of mortality to the next life of immortality where we live forever and ever and ever. With God. And the Apostle Paul said it like this. He says, this is going to be so amazing. Your eyes have not seen. Your ears have not heard. It has not entered into your heart what God has prepared for those that love him. Because it's a mystery. But he says, I'm going to reveal these things to you by my Spirit. We need the Holy Spirit to make it through all this. When you travel around the world, when we went to Tanzania, and they got in Tanzania and Africa, there's only like one point, in Africa's got a lot of population, only 1.7 billion people are Christians, and there's a whole lot more people than that. So when we go to preach, 80% of them are Muslim or something else, and they don't know about life after death. They don't know about the healing power of God. And God shows up, and we preach the resurrection of Jesus Christ. And if Jesus came out of the grave, if God raised him from the dead, resurrection power can resurrect your marriage, can resurrect your body, can resurrect your job, can resurrect whatever's going on in your life. He can bring life to whatever's happening in your life today. That's resurrection. Amen. So we talk about this doctrine of the resurrection of the dead. And the last one is says, and of eternal judgment. And this we will do if God permits. Without us realizing there's going to be a judgment, some of us will never change. There's going to be accountability for everything that's going on in your life and in this world. But when you have Jesus, you have the forgiveness of your sin. You are not going to have to pay for your sins. Jesus Christ paid for your sins. Somebody say hallelujah. And because he was raised from the dead, that seals it. Your sins are forgiven. He died for the forgiveness of sin, and he proved he was God by being raised from the dead. Not resuscitated, but raised. I want to just share a few points with you. Number one, every one of us have an appointment with death. If you're taking notes, you have an appointment. Are you ready? You should be. It says this, O death, where is your sting? That's 1 Corinthians 15:55. We talked about the sting of death. Also in Ecclesiastes chapter 12, verse 7, it says, our bodies will return to the dust when we die, and our spirit will return to God. Amen. Ecclesiastes 12, 7. You know why your spirit is going to return to God? Because it came from God. And your spirit longs to be with God. And if we get everything else out of the way, the flesh, the world, the devil, there's something in you that just draws you. That's why you're here this morning. Something inside of you draws you to God, connects you to God. You long to be with God. But the world, the devil, and your flesh has all these distractions, and we start longing for all those things, and we forget, we don't see, we get blinded to God. It says the devil blinds the minds of them that believe not. And so we're going through life, and we're trying to pursue all this stuff to fill our deepest need, but your spirit can only, its need can only be met by being connected to God. And that's what being born again is, by the way. Your spirit and God's spirit become one. You become spiritually alive. Your spirit becomes perfect, but your soul, your mind, your will, your emotions, everything else about you is going to be being saved. It's going to be being changed. It's going to be being renewed, being healed. Just like your body, when it gets sick, your body needs to be healed. Your soul needs to be healed. Your mind needs to be healed. You ever heard of mental illness? You ever heard of emotional breakdown? Where your will doesn't even want to will to do anything for God? Or what's right? You just give up? And people lose their lives because they're sick mentally or in their soul. They're hurt. I'll tell you what. You know what hurts a lot? A broken heart. Anybody had a broken heart that almost killed you? You got to let God heal it. You getting anything out of this today? Come on now. Resurrection power can do it. Amen. So yeah, your body's going to go back to the dirt, this mortal thing. That's why I don't need it to come out of the dirt. I got one in heaven. Go read, Romans chapter 4. He'll talk about that in 5. And this too. It's appointed unto us to die, but there's also going to be a destination when you die. Let's talk about our destination. Where are you going when you die? If you are a believer, you're going into paradise. You're going to be with the Lord. You're going to a place called heaven. Now, what is heaven like? Well, if you watch Hollywood, you got some little wings, you're always wearing something white, and you're walking in a cloud of smoke about up to your knees, and you're playing a harp. Sound like hell to me. Come on. Do y'all realize that this planet, and you know, whenever they do that, everything's white. The God who made the rainbow and all the colors, you think heaven's going to just be just white? It's going to be so amazing. Paul said, our eyes have not seen, our ears have not heard. It's going to be so beautiful. This earth is beautiful. Have y'all ever been in some beautiful places on earth? Amen. I've been in some magnificent places. I've been praying on the side of a river before, and God just put on a nature show for me. Just showing off. this earth which is fallen and broken and sin has come into it, and it actually says it's groaning like a woman with birth pangs waiting for the revelation of the sons of God because it wants to be redeemed. Heaven's going to be this times blow your mind. Amen? I mean, they had a paradise, Adam and Eve, and they could eat of everything in there. I mean, it was for them, but they couldn't. He said, don't eat the tree of the knowledge of good and evil, but you know how we are. We're going to get the one thing God says, don't touch, don't eat. He didn't say don't touch it, don't eat it. And sin came. But the Bible talks about the New Jerusalem coming down out of heaven, talks about the fruit trees, talks about the lion laying down with the lamb, talks about the golden streets, talks about, I mean, it's going to be so amazing. And I don't think we're just going to sit around with a harp and play a harp or sit on the beach drinking pina coladas. We're going to be worshiping God and doing, it says the grace of God is going to be being unfolded to us for eternity. We're just at the beginning, guys. Amen. Heaven or hell? Go with me to Luke chapter 16, verse 19. Again, I am confident, the Bible says in 2 Corinthians 5:8, yes, well, please, rather to be absent from the body is to be present with the Lord. So this is Jesus talking about the rich man and Lazarus. And he's going to give us some theology here, okay? He's going to teach us what it's like to see on the other side. So this is Jesus speaking. There was a certain rich man who was clothed with purple and fine linen, who fared sumptuously, that's not a word I normally use, every day. He was well off. But there was a certain beggar named Lazarus, full of sores, who was laid at his gate, desiring to be fed with the crumbs which fell from the rich man's table. Moreover, dogs came and licked his sores. That don't sound too good, does it? So it was that the beggar died. Oh, the beggar died and was carried by the angels to Abraham's bosom, and the rich man also died and was buried. I don't care how rich or poor you are. It doesn't matter the color of your skin. Man, woman, come on. When you're going to die. It's appointed unto us to die. And Lazarus is taken with angels. Say angels. What happens when a Christian dies? There's going to be angels there to carry you to the bosom of Abraham, which is paradise, which is the place where those who believe in Christ, the Father of faith. And I know some old theologians and some churches will teach that the bosom of Abraham is the upper regions of hell. Well, when I die, I don't want the angels to bring me to hell. I don't care if it's the upper regions. I don't even want to be in the upper regions of hell. I want to be in heaven. I want to be in paradise. I want to be in the bosom of Abraham, which is paradise. Amen. Amen. So why add stuff in there that's not in there? But the rich man died and was buried, and being in torment in Hades, boy, he just ended up in a bad place. He lifted his eyes and saw Abraham afar off, Lazarus in his bosom. And he cried out, saying, Father Abraham, have mercy on me, and send Lazarus that he might dip his finger in water and cool my tongue, for I am tormented in these flames. Ay, ay, ay. I don't know if y'all know what that means in Cajun. That's not good. He's being tormented in flames, but he could still see into the paradise that he's not in. And he speaks to Abraham, and he's still giving commands. Get this. That's how arrogant this guy is. He's now in torment, and he's still trying to tell them to do something for him. He did start off with, have mercy on me. But he says, just have him dip his finger in water and come cool my tongue. I heard it said this way, one drop of heaven's water can cool the fires of hell. Ooh. The only thing is, it don't work that way. If you're in the bosom of Abraham or in heaven and somebody's in hell, there's no crossing over, and he's going to tell us. Abraham said, son, remember that in your lifetime you received your good things and Lazarus received evil things. But now he is comforted and you are tormented. Besides all this, this is an important scripture. Between us and you, there is a great gulf fixed, so that those who want to pass from here cannot, so that those who want to pass from here to you cannot, nor can those from there pass to us. Now Jesus is saying, Lazarus in paradise, the rich man's in torment. And he says, send him over to cool my tongue. And he says, he can't come over. And he says, nobody from your side can go over there. And he doesn't really get it, because he's going to ask that Lazarus goes to his brother's house. In other words, when you die, your destiny is already fixed. And if you believe that you can cross over after you're dead, you forgot that you need to take care of that before you die. You'll get that. After you die, you're fixed. And if you're on this side, you're not going to that side. If you're on that side, you're not going to the other side. And there's no place where you can work off your sins and cross over. And like the Mormons teach, you can have somebody in your family or somebody that's alive get baptized so that you can get saved after you die. Cross you back over from hell back to heaven. You need to make your destiny fixed today. You need to know that Jesus died for your sins, was buried, and was raised from the dead. And you need to know that you need to have your sins forgiven. Because if you don't think you have sin, you're a fool. All have sinned. I need forgiveness every day. I don't know about you. You know, during my lifetime, after I've been saved, I've done some stupid stuff. Amen, Pastor Mark. Me too, but you don't have to say it out loud. But God is good, and he'll forgive you. So listen to what he says. Then he said, I beg you, this is the rich man, I beg you, Father, that you would send him, Lazarus, to my father's house. For I have five brothers, that they may testify, that he may testify to them, lest they also come to this place of torment. So he's kind of concerned about his brothers. He's there. He said, no. You know, once you're there, you're going to wish you wasn't? Come on. So nobody said amen. Amen. If you're in hell, you're going to wish you wasn't? Amen. It makes me think about this. When you wake up with a hangover on Saturday morning, you wish you wouldn't have drank Friday night. But before we think about it, before the consequences come, we think everything's going to be all right. Abraham said to him, they have Moses and the prophets, let them hear them. And he said, no, Father Abraham, but if one goes to them from the dead, they will repent. And he said to him, if they do not hear Moses and the prophets, neither will they be persuaded or repent, though one is raised from the dead. So everybody thinks that if you see something supernatural, it's going to change you. If you don't believe the law and the prophets, the word of God, you're not going to believe even if someone comes back from the dead. Because there's people that have superstitions, and if I step on your toes, God can heal them. That you're sleeping and you wake up in the middle of the night and Aunt Susie's standing in at the end of the bed talking to you. A ghost or an apparition. Not in the Bible. Amen. When Jesus appeared, he said, come, touch me, handle me. Put your hand here. Put your hand in my side. Let's have some fish and honeycomb. He would appear in the room. After he was raised from the dead, he appeared to his disciples and showed himself alive from the dead, supernatural with his immortal body. And prove, it says in Acts chapter 1, verse 3, with infallible proofs, he showed them that he was alive. For 40 days he appeared. For the account of time, instead of reading all the scripture, I'll tell you, he appeared to Peter, he appeared to James, he appeared to all the apostles, he appeared to 500 brethren at one time. He was speaking to a group of people, and the apostle Paul, when he writes that in 1 Corinthians chapter 15, he says, among whom many of them still are alive today. In other words, you're reading my letter and go confirm it with the people that are still walking around on the planet that saw me risen. Now, people can go to jail and get the death penalty for two witnesses. There's over 600 witnesses that saw him. And they were alive, and it was written in the letter. And Paul said he also appeared to me as one out of due season when he was on the road to Damascus, raised from the dead. He proved that he was alive. Now, y'all get this. It was the biggest thing happening in the world at that time. Jesus Christ, the miracle worker, the one who went down into the temple, the one who turned over the tables of the money changers, healed those who were in the temple. And he said, my house should be called a house of prayer, but you made it a den of thieves. And he says, and he healed the lame and the blind who were in the temple that day. That's on Holy Week. He did all that in front of them. He proclaimed he was the Messiah. Then what did they do? They planned to kill him. Judas betrayed him with a kiss. Then when they finally caught him in the garden, what did they do? He was already in agony, sweating with drops of blood coming off of his face in agony, saying, Father, if it's possible to let this cup pass me by, but not my will, thy will be done. Because he could have called for a legion of angels to come take him off the cross or take him away from that. Then they beat him. They pull his beard out. They put crown of thorns on his head. Then they put him on a whipping post and lashed his back open. It says it looked like a field that had just been plowed. And everybody was watching all this take place. And here he goes walking down, going to Golgotha's hill, carrying the cross. Crowds were shouting and they were mocking him. Then they take him out of the temple and they go up on Golgotha's hill, Calvary, which means the hill of the skull. Calvary means skull. Golgotha means skull. And there, having help to carry it, he needed help to carry it. Simon helped him carry it up there. Then they lay him down and he puts his hands out. And you know what? Who killed Jesus? Who planned for him to do this? Not the Romans. The Romans were just a tool of God's plan. But he lay, because he said no one could take his life. He had to lay it down. And everybody could see this. Nailed his hands and his feet. Crown of thorns, put him up bleeding. It says when he was on the cross, you could not even recognize he was a man. Hung him between two thieves. On a hill, you could, from the temple court, you could see Calvary and you could see the three crosses. This was the biggest thing that ever happened. And then the centurion there, he dies. They said, you need to get him off before the Sabbath comes. They had to take him down as soon as they could and put him in the grave before that Sabbath, which Saturday was coming at 6 o'clock our time in the evening. So they took him off the cross at 3. But they were going to break his legs, but he was already dead because he gave it up, which is a whole other teaching, the wonderful things he said while he was on the cross. But he says, into your hand I commit my spirit, and he breathed his last. But while he was on the cross, what did he say to the thief? Today, I will be with you in what? Oh, not hell. Not hell. I don't know why people want to say he died on the cross and went to hell. He died on the cross and took with him that thief into paradise. And there he says, in 3 days, I will rebuild the temple. They thought he was talking about the stones. He was talking about this. You're the temple. While he was there, he cleansed this temple. So now, after the resurrection, Jesus Christ can now live in you. The Holy Spirit now lives in us. And we need to believe it and act like it and understand the only way we're going to change the world is by the power of the Holy Spirit that lives in us. That's why when you die, you don't only have angels, you've got God. Who said, I'll never leave you nor forsake you. He is already in you, and your spirit and his spirit is already one. And let me tell you, you do not want to die without him. Amen. That's why you must be born again before you die. You must accept Amen. It before you die. You don't wait till after death to find out if you go to heaven. Too late. Glory to God. I think I'm going to get this tape and listen to it. The resurrection. So this didn't happen in the corner in a jungle somewhere. This was the biggest event in the world. So just think, after he dies, the centurion said, this must be the Son of God. Then they wanted him to be sure. Is that? So he took a spear and pierced his side, and blood and water flowed. His body was torn up. He was dead. They took him off the cross, and then they put him in a rich man's tomb. Come on. You know what a rich man's tomb is? It's a family tomb. You know why it was like a cave with a rock in front of it? Because it's an esophagus. There's families that have tombs like this in New Orleans. I don't know if you've ever been to New Orleans. You can walk into some of these tombs, and they got the family members are on the wall, the skeletons. And whenever it gets too full, they push the bones back to put the next body in that want to. So they have a big door, a big rock they can roll away. So it wasn't unusual to be able to roll away the rock. That's why they said, put a seal on it so that nobody opens it. We want to make sure that he stays in that grave. When the ladies came that morning, guess what? The seal was broken. The stone was rolled away. And she goes in and says, they took his body. I want to ask you something. If you was going to steal somebody's body that was in the grave, would you take their clothes off? Wouldn't you steal it with the clothes on them? I mean, I would. I wouldn't want to carry a naked body around if I had some clothes on it. I'm going to steal a body and just take it with the clothes. But the clothes were folded and put neatly. Because he had some other garments he was putting on now. Amen? And then she turns to leave and she hears, Mary, Mary. She knew that voice. And it was Jesus. And he says, go tell my disciples and Peter that I'm alive. The two angels in there says, what are you looking for the dead among the living? He is risen. So they just saw this man get brutally tortured, crucified. And for the next 40 days, he walks around and talks to them and shows them that he's alive, appears in the room while they're in there hiding from the Sanhedrin and the soldiers, and he just, poof, they all freak out, it says. That's how my paraphrase. Don't be afraid. I'm not a ghost. Come handle me, touch me. So if there's a ghost in your room, it ain't God. If it's an angel can open doors, and those two angels look like men. The Bible in one place says they're called men, another place they're called angels. Some of you ought to study this book. It's amazing. Amen. It's amazing. And here he is. Next thing you know, he goes and there's a meeting with 500 people. And he goes and he talks to all 500. The same one that they saw crucified, died, tore up, bloody, is appearing to them, showing them that he's alive. Not resuscitated, resurrected. Because a resuscitated body don't just appear in rooms. So I don't know what we're going to be like, but I know it says we're going to be like him. So I don't know, I might just appear in one of your rooms in heaven. I say, hey, Pastor Mark's here. He said, could you knock first? I didn't have to. But see, our little brains can't hardly comprehend what's going to happen on the other side of this. But guys, I believe in eternal life. I believe in life after this life. Therefore, because of the resurrection, we believe that death has been conquered. We know that we're going to have a great family reunion. And because of the resurrection, we should not be afraid of death. Through that, he has conquered the fear of death. And then we can talk beyond death. Wow. What's it going to be like? All I know is Jesus is coming again. Just like they didn't think he was going to come that time. And he did. He's coming again. The last part of the entire Bible says, I'm coming again. May the grace of our Lord Jesus Christ be with you all. Amen. So we need grace until he comes. I need some grace. So I don't want to be one of these Christians that don't believe in the resurrection. I mean, if you don't believe in the resurrection, what's the point of you being here? Amen. The Bible actually says if you don't believe, it says that it's futile. If there's no resurrection, our faith is futile, our preaching is futile. Everything we're doing says eat, drink, and be merry, for tomorrow you die. But there's so much more. So much more. Y'all can come on up, ladies. We have a special for y'all. Then we're going to do communion right after that. This is a very special song. Friday was an amazing day. Okay, I'm taking her word. She said, yeah, let's move it.
Great light dawns in Galilee. Some say madman, some say king. Wonder working rebel priest. Jesus Christ the Nazarene. All from sin and grave. A perfect man would have to die, and only he could pay that price. Friday's good 'cause Sunday's coming. Don't lose hope 'cause Sunday's coming. Devil, you're done, you better start running. Friday's good 'cause Sunday's coming. So we let those soldiers take him in, as his friend betrayed him with a kiss. There before the mocking crowd, the nails went in and the sky went dark. The redemption of the world was on his heart. Friday's good 'cause Sunday's coming. Don't lose hope 'cause Sunday's coming. Thank you.
Then he breathed his last and bowed his head. The Son of God and man was dead. With bloody hands, tears on their face, they laid him down inside that grave. That wasn't the end. That wasn't the end. That wasn't the end. Let me tell you what happened then. The women came before the dawn to find that stone already gone. When they looked inside, the angel said, "Why you looking for the living among the dead? He's alive, he's alive. Hallelujah, he's alive. Give him praise, lift him high. Hallelujah, he's alive, he's alive, he's alive. Hallelujah, he's alive. Give him praise, lift him high. Hallelujah, he's throne. All heaven sings to him alone. We watch and wait like a bride for a groom. Oh, church, arise, he's coming soon.
Hallelujah. He's coming. He's coming soon. Amen. Before we come for communion, I always want to give the opportunity, if you've never given your life to Christ, the way you do that is you stand for him. If you confess him, he confesses you. If you deny him, he denies you. But if he's drawing you today, and you could have been religious all your life and known about him, but today you really want to be a follower of Jesus. That's what Christianity is. It's not joining a religion or a church. It's following him and letting him live in your heart, inviting him to be your Lord and surrendering your life to him. If your heart's moving right now and God's drawing you, and today's the day that you want to say, "Pastor Mark, I want to make him the Lord of my life." Would you stand with me? If that's you, come down. I want to pray with you. Come on, it takes courage to step out for Jesus. Amen. If you're in this place today, you say, "Today I am going to become a follower of Jesus Christ. Not just know about him, not just think about him, but surrender to him." Amen. Love you more. Come on, who else? Come on, if your heart is racing, it's you. Don't let your heart keep you your head keep you from where your heart wants to take you. Because the best days are ahead of you. Amen. There's forgiveness. There's a new beginning. There's God's power. Resurrection life will come and live on the inside of you. Amen. Come on. I sense there's somebody. If God's got a hold of your heart, let him have it. Quit resisting. Surrender. Surrender. Let's pray. Y'all pray with him. Say, "Heavenly Father, I'm sorry and I repent of all my sins. I believe in my heart that Jesus Christ is the Son of God, that he died for my sins, that he was buried, and that he was raised from the dead. I believe he's alive, and today I receive him as my Savior, and I ask him to be my Lord. I will follow you, Jesus, all the days of my life. Thank you for your grace and mercy. In Jesus' name. Amen. Father, make yourself so real to them. Real. In Jesus' name. Reveal yourself in a powerful, powerful way. I pray in Jesus' name. Amen. Amen. Congratulations. This is the beginning. Amen. Hallelujah. He's alive. Get the basket, and we're going to have it here for the offering. For God so loved the world, he gave his son for you and me. So today, give for him, because you can't outgive God. Amen. It says, when you give to the Lord, he will repay. If you give bountifully, you will reap bountifully. Amen. We put our faith in him. He said this. He said, if you will bring your tithes and offerings, he will open up the windows of heaven and pour out for you such a blessing, you won't have enough room to receive it, and he will rebuke the devil, the devourer, for your sake. If you need the devil rebuked, this is one of the ways the Bible says to do it. Then we're going to come to, after you, while you bring your offering, go on each side of the table, get the cup and the bread and hold it, and we're going to pray over it together and take all together. Y'all can come now and bring your offering to come serve yourselves. Come down the middle. Yeah, if you need assistance, if you're sitting down, we can sure bring it to you if you can't make it. Hallelujah. He's alive.
He became sin, who knew no sin, that we might become his righteousness. He humbled himself and carried the cross. Love so amazing. Love so amazing. Jesus Messiah.
Our rescue.
The rescue for sinners. The ransom from heaven. Jesus Messiah. Lord of all.
Body the bread.
His body the bread. His blood the wine. Broken and poured out, all for love. The whole earth trembled, and the veil was torn. Love so amazing. Love so amazing. Yeah. Jesus Messiah.
Praise the Lord. Your name's Madison. You love the Lord. Say, Heavenly Father, I repent of all my sins, and I believe in my heart that Jesus Christ is the Son of God, that he gave his life for me, that he was buried, and he was raised from the dead. Lord Jesus, I ask you to be my Lord and my Savior. Thank you for saving me. I will follow you in Jesus' name. Amen and amen. Father, bless her. with a great future. Wash away all of her sins. Wash away all of the problems. Turn every curse into a blessing, I pray in Jesus' name. Amen. Amen. Praise the Lord. Amen. You can get you a Don, get me a cup after you. Get that Bible from Mr. Don over there. We want to give you that. Isn't that exciting? You know, it says the angels are rejoicing in heaven right now. Glory over one sinner that repents and turns their life to Christ. Glory to God. On the night that he was betrayed, he took bread and he broke it and he gave it to his disciples. He said, take this and eat it, for this is my body which is given up for you. In the same manner, he took the cup of the new and everlasting covenant. And he says, drink this in remembrance of me. For as often as you eat this bread and drink this cup, you proclaim the Lord's death until he comes again. Father, I bless this bread and this cup in the name of the Father and of the Son and of the Holy Spirit. In Jesus' name, it becomes for us spiritual food and drink, healing for our bodies and forgiveness for our souls. Thank you for your love. In Jesus' name I pray. Amen. Y'all enjoy this today? Amen and amen. It's so good to see all of you. I would pray that y'all start coming back and receiving the Word of God and being part of what God's doing here. Many hands make a light load. We'd love you to be part of the ones who serve and can help. We really want to get our children's ministry and our nursery and toddlers' ministries going again and eventually get a youth group going. And Get things alive again. Amen? Amen? But I can't do it all myself. Amen? It takes more than three people. It takes a body. Many hands make a light load. Father, we come to you in Jesus' name, thanking you for the promise of the resurrection. We believe. Lord, you showed yourself. You proved that you died and you rose again. You're seated at the right hand of the Father, and Lord Jesus, your bride, your church has come. We're not afraid for you to come. We're not afraid to meet you in the air. Amen. And we're not afraid of death because you are the resurrection. Lord, you said in your word, let not our hearts be troubled. We don't want to have troubled hearts. We believe in you, and we believe that you prepared a place for those that are prepared. Bless our Easter day. Bless our families, as we gather together celebrating your resurrection, may we share your love with everyone we meet. I pray in Jesus' name. May the Lord bless you and keep you. May the Lord make his face shine on you. Be gracious to you, lift his countenance upon you, and give you peace. I bless you all in the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit, in the name of Jesus Christ, our Lord and Savior. Amen. Amen. Happy Resurrection Day. Shake somebody's hand. Thank you all for worshiping God with us today.